Good morning. This is Pastor Dan Bentz from Dixon's Northside Baptist Church, welcoming you to our worship services as we gather together in this virtual environment for the sixth consecutive week, worshiping and praising and exalting the name of our Savior. We're so glad that you've chosen to join us, and we're excited about the opportunity that we have each week to come together and to celebrate Jesus and His wonderful work in our lives. These are strange times, difficult in many ways, but our God is still mighty and powerful, and we trust Him in all things. And we know that we can trust Him as we worship and give ourselves to Him this morning. Let me just share with you a couple of real quick announcements, some things that you might need to be aware of before we continue with our services. First of all, I want to say just a huge thank you to everyone for your continuing and consistent financial support of our church and our ministry here. We are so very grateful for that. You have done just a wonderful job in continuing your support through your tithes and offerings, and we're just unbelievably grateful for that. And it's just an opportunity for us to say to you, thank you for all that you do, because you're making a difference not only for us, but for many other people that we support through our ministries as well. And so just thank you for that. Just be reminded that you can send your gifts to the church, 598 River Lane, Dixon, and we'll just take care of it through the mail that way. If you'd rather drop them off by the church, feel free to do that. And you can just place them in the church office and we'll take care of it from that perspective. Also, I wanted to share with you just an encouragement to go back to our church website from time to time and see some additional resources that we're placing there. You have an opportunity there to submit prayer requests and to get our daily Bible readings. And we're going to be adding more and more material there each week. And so I just want to encourage you to return to that website, www.northsidedixon.com. And it'll be an opportunity for you just to get some more information, some more insight, some pertinent announcements about some things that are ongoing as we work our way through the last days, we hope, of this time of separation as a result of this pandemic. Now, there's one other thing I wanted to share with you this morning, one other thought that I had. I just, you know, as I was sitting in my office this week and praying and just thinking about all the things that God has been blessing us with through this difficult time that we've been going through, I was reminded that, you know, as much as we can have joy-filled worship, singing songs of praise and worship to our Lord and fellowshipping together in His Word, there's one part of our worship that's missing, and that's that togetherness. We don't get to hear each other's stories. We're not hearing what's happening in each other's lives. And so what I want to do is I want to encourage you to help alleviate some of that problem. Here's how we can do that. I'd like for you to consider making a 2 or 3 minute video, just a testimony of maybe some things that God has done in your life or some exciting things that you've experienced, ways that you've been able to share your faith, ways that you've connected with your neighbors or friends, just some things that has been a blessing to you personally, and then share it with me so that I can include it in our worship next week. We'll also post them on our website. If we have more than enough, we want to just include that, because it's going to be an opportunity for us to see each other, to connect with each other, and to see each other's stories. So just use your phone, your tablet, your computer, whatever one you want to. Make a 2 or 3 minute video. Send it to me via email, dan@northsidedixon.com. And we'll include some of that, if we can, in next week's worship time. So I think it'll be a great opportunity to do that. And I encourage you to be a part of that. Let's begin this morning. Let's just go to the Lord in prayer and ask Him to bless us as we worship together. Heavenly Father, we come into Your presence. We're grateful and we're thankful for the joy that You've given us to be Your people. And even in the most difficult times that we face, we know that we're not alone. You're there with us. You're walking alongside of us, strengthening and enabling us, making our lives complete in ways that we could never experience apart from You. And so, God, I ask Your blessing upon us today as we worship You. Lead us in the songs, Lord. Just let our hearts rejoice and soar as we sing these songs of praise to You. And, Lord, when it comes time for Your Word to be opened, I just pray for Your enlightening Spirit, Lord, that You'll put the words in my heart and in my mouth to share with the congregation that is gathered. and that everyone who's listening, Lord, will hear what you have to say to them personally, and they'll be blessed by that. God, I know this is going to be a special time, and I'm excited about what you're going to do. Bless us and guide us now. For it's in your precious and holy name we pray. Amen.
Endures forever. Sing praise. God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever.
Rising to the setting sun, His love endures forever. And by the grace of God, we will carry on.
His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. Forever.
Everyone wants to be happy. It influences everything we do, what job we take, whom we marry, where we live. We all want happiness. We may seek it in different ways and in different things, but we do seek it, and we do whatever we can to have it. On the other hand, there is a great, powerful, wise God. He made us, He defines what our lives are for, and one day He will judge the world, and the issue will be, did we honor Him? Did we thank Him? So we have to choose, right? My happiness or God's glory? That's what it felt like to me for many years. And then I made one of the greatest discoveries of my life. You might say it started when I was 6 years old. Even then, I knew I was a sinner. There was no way I was good enough for heaven. So when my parents showed me that Jesus Christ died for sinners, even sinners like me, I wanted Him. I welcomed Him. But it wasn't until my early 20s that I saw that my desire to be happy and God's desire to be glorified were not at odds. I found in the Bible that they were, in fact, one thing. When you enjoy somebody a lot, you show everyone how important they are to you. We get the joy, God gets the glory. If I stop enjoying God, I stop glorifying God. This was almost too good to be true. I had learned one of the most important things in the world. God is most glorified in me when I am most satisfied in Him.
Over the mountains and the sea, Your river runs with love for me, and I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands, for I will always sing of when Your love came down.
I could sing of Your love forever. 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 Over the mountains and the sea, Your river runs with love for me, and I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands, for I will always sing of when Your love came down. I could sing of Your love forever. I could sing of Your love.
could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever.
Oh, I feel like dancing. I know, but when the world has seen the light,
they will dance with joy like we're dancing now. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love.
Lord Jesus, I just pray that in these next moments that you'll speak to us through your word, that you will reveal by your spirit the truth that you want us to carry away from this message, that, Lord, your life might be glorified through ours, and that, Lord, in all that we do and all that we say, we might honor you and praise you before family, friends, neighbors, co-workers, and all that we meet, that you might be glorified through your church this week. We love you, Lord. It's in your precious and holy name we pray. Amen. You know, I'm sure at one time or another, we've all had what we sometimes think of as those moments when the light bulb finally comes on. You know, we just kind of get something that we've not been able to quite figure out in the past, something that hasn't been clear to us, something that we've struggled with understanding. And all of a sudden, whether it's through circumstance or someone's teaching, it just becomes clear to us and we get it finally. That can be an exhilarating moment for us. It can be exciting to know that suddenly we don't have to deal with uncertainty, but we can know with a relative sense of certainty, this is what's true and this is what's right. And we just feel comfortable and confident because we finally get what we were looking for. You know, I've noticed those same kind of moments come in our Christian walk as well. You know, there are times in our lives, it seems like when God begins to reveal greater truth to us, more of himself, more of his nature, more of his ways to us, and about the things that he's trying to do in our life. Usually these moments come when he's trying to stretch us just a little bit and show us a new avenue of ministry or a new opportunity to serve him or a new direction that he's calling for us to go that's going to require greater dependence upon him and a greater resilience and a greater commitment to his word. And so he just reveals a new truth, something that maybe had been hidden from us for a long time, but suddenly we just get it. And we know that's what God wants us to do, and he's pointing us in a direction, and he's asking us to go that way. God's ready to show something special in our life, and he prepares us for that, and he does that in a wonderful and magnificent way. And what's really exciting about that is that I've discovered that this is not just for new Christians. This is not just for those who are just walking in their faith and taking those first baby steps of faith. It doesn't matter how long you've been in the faith or how long you've been walking with the Lord. One of the greatest joys is having that moment when God reveals greater truth to you and he says, come with me and follow me and walk with me as we go a little bit further down the road of faithfulness and devotion to him. And it's an exciting journey that we all get to share in and we all get to be a part of. Well, David, he had a sense like that as well. I mean, there seems to be a moment in time in his life where he came to understand that because he trusted God, and because that trust was so real and so powerful in his life, that it enabled him to experience life in dimensions he had never considered before. And he shares a little bit of that with us in the 16th Psalm. So if you have your Bibles this morning, I'd like for you to turn with me to that passage of Scripture, and together, let's look at what David has to say. Now, I need to share with you that this is a much longer passage than we're going to be able to look at this morning. In order to do justice to this, I only want to look at the last section of what David is talking about. And I would encourage you to go back and read the previous verses and just really note what David is talking about. We'll mention a couple of those things in just a moment. But just be reminded that we're going to be looking at the culmination of what David is saying, God has revealed to me, and how it's changed him, and how it brought a new sense of God's presence to his life. So you follow along with me as we read together from Psalm 16, and I'll begin reading with verse 9, and we'll continue through verse 11. Therefore, my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body also will rest secure, because you will not abandon me to the grave, nor will you let your Holy One see decay. You have known me in the path of life, you have made known to me the path of life, and you will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. Now, I've told you many times in the past, when you're reading Scripture and you come to a word, therefore, it requires that you kind of go backward a little bit and see what led to that point, what was being said previous to that, so that you can fully understand what it is that led the writer to say, because of all of these things, this is what I'm saying now. And that's kind of what we need to do at this point. So I want you to go back, and I want you to notice with me just real quickly as you survey the first verses in Psalm 16, and notice the words that he uses. The psalmist is saying words of praise and gratitude because he is confident and contented in the Lord because of his trust in what God has done for him. You know, when you have a chance, just take a marker out and just mark in your Bibles some of the special phrases that he makes. He says in verse 2, for example, that apart from you, I have no good thing. Well, we could relate to that, can't we? I mean, we all understand that away from God, we don't have anything that's of any value, at least not any eternal value. And all of the blessings, all of the wonderful things, all that's good and holy comes to us from the Father of lights, which is above. And we're so grateful for that. And so David speaks of that. He talks about the futility of running after worldly things. That's a lesson a lot of people can learn today as well. And how life is only secure when he has set the Lord before him. All of those things are going to be important. And those are the things that led up to his statement. Now, seeing these things and understanding them is important, not just because they set the stage for how he concludes this psalm, but because they relate very clearly to our lives and the way that we live our lives today. I mean, how many of you have ever struggled in those moments of life where it just seems like there's something in the world that catches your eye and you just can't seem to get it off your heart and mind? It's there, and before you realize it, you have almost a compulsion, almost a sense of desperation. I want to have that. I need that in my life. And it's beginning to consume you, and it's beginning to lead you in a way that you have to have that thing or that person or whatever it is that has caught your eye in life. How much better would our lives be if we would live them with the sense that the best for me is always going to come from God. And if I'm going to be consumed by desire for anything, let it be consumed by my desire for Him and for His presence in my life. Or how many of you have ever struggled through those days of life thinking like you were just bound with despair and loneliness because it just seems like something bad is going to happen to you sooner or later and you just can't get those feelings out of your mind? Well, bad days come to all of us. I mean, that's just the reality of life. But realizing that our lives are held secure in the hands of God, That takes away all the anxiety. That takes away all of the trepidation that we might have. And it brings us to a point of confidence, and it brings us to a point of joy where we can rejoice in the Lord. And I think David's understanding that. I mean, nothing can ever separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. That's the promise of God's Word. And when we embrace that, it brings confidence and joy and a desire to step out in faith and just trust God in greater ways than we ever have before. Well, David has come to realize what a wonderful thing it is to live in this security with God and with this confidence in the Lord. And so he just lives out that every day in his life, and it changed everything about him. Now, let me show you what I mean as we look together in the scriptures. And I think that it's best to see that it begins with this understanding that joy began to permeate every part of his being. You know, I want to make sure you understand where this joy comes from, okay? Because it's easy for us to try to read something in here that maybe wouldn't be appropriate at this point. It's not just because he loves God and he's acknowledged God's right of lordship in his life and he's come to live in obedience to God. That's not just the reason for joy, although those are wonderful things and we all need to choose them. I think there's been a lot of Christians that I've known over the years that loved God genuinely, that probably lived obediently before the Lord, but it seemed like their life had anything except joy in it. It was almost like they were going through a mundane existence of day after day after day, just doing the things that they were doing and never really experiencing the full joy of walking in faith and fellowship with the Lord. What makes the difference here, and you want to get this, what makes the difference is not just an acknowledgement that God is our rock and our fortress, our ever-present help in our time of need, our portion and the source of strength for our lives, but really allowing him to become those things for us because we choose to live near him. Because we choose to put our lives before him, present before him, where he can mold us and make us into the individuals that he wants us to be. You see, real joy, the kind that's greater than circumstances, the kind that's greater than the situations that we face in life, something, it comes to us when we experience something that's greater than anything the world could ever bring against us. And my friends, that greater in our life is Christ Jesus. And so I want to challenge you right from the beginning here is to just put your life close to the Lord. Give your heart to him. Trust him to be Savior, Lord in your life, of course. But as a Christian, live in faith and fellowship. Live near him. Abide with him. Walk with him. Enjoy the fellowship with him. Can you imagine what it was like in the Garden of Eden when God came to walk with Adam and Eve in the cool of the evening? What a joyous fellowship that must have been. Well, in Christ, by the presence of the Holy Spirit, we can have that restored to us to a certain degree. We can walk with God. We can fellowship with God. We can feel his presence. We can feel his joy. We can be excited by him and directed by him. All those wonderful emotions that we get to experience because we are near God. But you know, there are two essential things that need to happen here. Number one, obviously, we need to trust Jesus to be Savior in our life. We need to come before him and we need to acknowledge the fact that we're sinners and that our sin has put a barrier of rebellion between us and him, and there's nothing that we can do in and of ourselves to remove that. And we need to trust what he has done for us at Calvary to pay for our sins and to give us an opportunity to return to God. And when we've done that, we need to allow him to become Lord in our lives. We need to choose to live before him. We need to choose to live obediently. We need to choose to live in the way that he desires for us, living out his purposes for our lives. Let me give you an example of what I'm talking about. Some of you may have heard of a fellow named Joe Scriven. He was an Irishman who was born to an affluent family who had a lot of things going for him, but he lived a very tragic life. He was educated at Trinity University in Dublin and fell in love with his childhood sweetheart and was ready to marry. And just on the eve of their marriage, his fiancée drowned in a swimming accident. Well, heartbroken, he left Ireland and moved to Canada, where he became a missionary to the Iroquois Indians there. And after a passage of time, God healed his heart. Things began to change for him. And he fell in love with another woman and ready to marry her. Well, just weeks before their marriage, she fell ill with pneumonia and eventually died. It was almost a grief beyond what he could bear in his life. And yet he turned to the Lord and he turned to him in faith and leaned hard into that faith. He began to write poetry. And about a year after his second fiance passed away, he wrote a letter back to his mother in Ireland, and he included a poem that you might find familiar. Let me just read to you what he said. He said, "What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege it is to carry everything to him in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer." You know, I don't know what happened in his life to lead him to that point, from the time that he suffered the tragic loss of his loved one to the point where he was able to write those words, except that God made himself real to him. God's power began to show up in his life in ways that maybe he had not experienced or even expected before. And God's presence became so real and so powerful to him that he knew that he could trust him no matter what. Do you know you can trust God the same way? You know, God wants to be there for you, and he wants to restore joy to your life. He wants to give you a hope and a future like anything greater than you can possibly imagine. God has that for you if you'll just turn your heart and your life towards him and trust him as Savior and Lord and live obediently to him as Lord in your life. Well, David seemed to understand that, and he came to make a wonderful choice of just choosing to trust God no matter what life would hand him. His desire was, I'm just going to trust the Lord, and I'm going to be faithful to him. And that should be our desire and our prayer as well. Well, please understand then that the joy that we're talking about is not, you know, just a joy trusting in God and just being, you know, living in some sort of a blissful ignorance about everything that's going on around us. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about a joy that comes from the certain knowledge that God will be our strength and our guide every moment of every day throughout all of our lives. And that's exactly why a nearness to God is so essential for each one of us. You know, when we allow our lives to drift spiritually, things begin to change for us, and usually not for the better. I mean, there are moments that we feel like we're all alone and we're distant from God rather than being close to him. And as a result of that, it seems like more joy leaks out of our life than is able to be poured into it. Suddenly we go to work and our work just becomes a drudgery, and it's little more than just a daily grind for us. We feel more and more isolated from our friends because it seems like we're not connecting with them like we used to. Our stress level is going up and our peace level is going down. We're at the end of our rope and we don't know what to do. Well, you know what? The Bible gives us an answer for that. The Bible tells us, as David came to understand himself, that we can ask God to restore the joy in our life. Sometime I'd like for you to read Psalm 86. And in verse 4 of Psalm 86, David cries out to God, and he simply says, "Bring joy to your servant's life, because I turn to you, Lord." Bring joy to your servant's life. Isn't that the plea that we've all had at one point or another in our lives? Oh God, I'm just so desperate right now. I'm at a point of the end of it all. I just don't understand why these things are happening to me, why these circumstances are that I have to face. I'm devoid of any joy. And we cry out to God, and he's ready to give us joy. But I want you to understand, this prayer that David is offering here, it's not like he's asking for just a little bit to get me through today. It's like he's saying, God, dump the whole load on me. Bring me a boatload of joy and let me experience the power of your presence, not just for today, but for all my tomorrows. I want to know the joy of just walking in faith and in fellowship with you and just experiencing the power of your presence in my life every single day. Give me something that the world can't take away. I tell you, that's my heart's desire for me personally, and I know it would be for you as well. We want something that the world can't take away from us. We want the joy of God's presence. And so David, as he looked at these words, he recognized, you know, I just can't be silent about what God's done. He's brought joy to me. He's brought a peace that passes all understanding. He's given me a hope for the future. He's done something that nothing in the world could ever make possible for me. He has made it possible, and I want to rejoice in Him. And I think that's when he began to write those words from Psalm 16 that we read earlier about the joy of being in God's presence and the excitement about being secure in His hands and the folly of walking after the ways of the world when God is ever before us. And as he lifted his voice with praise, I think that light bulb moment came for him. And he realized at that moment, my God, you're so great and you're so wonderful and you're so amazing. What an awesome joy it is for me to come and give my life to you and experience you every moment of every day. And along with that, something else equally exciting happened. Now, it says in Scripture that the path of his life became clear. Now go back to with me in your Bibles to Psalm 16 for a moment, and I want you to get this with me. In Psalm 16, verse 11, it says, "You have made known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy because of your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand." You know, over the years of my ministry, I've had lots of people come to me and say things like, "Pastor, I'm not exactly sure what God wants to do in my life, or I'm not exactly sure what I need to be doing with my life, or what my purpose is, or what direction I'm supposed to go." Isn't it wonderful to know that God's already got that figured out? He's given us the path of our life. This is what David says. He's made known to me the path of life. Now, let me say something about paths. I've been on a lot of different ones in my life, and I noticed that they all have something in common. They all lead to a destination. And it's no different with the path that we call life in general. You know, for some who are wise in the ways of this world, or at least think that they are, they'll say that the ultimate end for the path of life is death. Well, David, he knew better than that. And I think some ways when we look at this world, we'll say that the ultimate end is death. But David sensed something more than that. You know, remember, this is the guy who wrote, "Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me." You know, Satan wants nothing more than to rob us of the joy and the vitality of our life, the contentment that comes in our relationship with Christ. And one of the great ways that he tries to do that is to take and bring us the burden of knowing that one day we're going to leave this flesh in death. But when that weapon is taken away from him, something changes about us. Because you see, what we realize is that the greater joy is not just coming, living our lives and then going to the end of our days, and that's all it'll be. God is leading us not to death, but to a greater life. David understood that pathway, it was the eternal presence of being with God. That was what awaited him. That was not something to dread or not something to look away from. That was something to long for in his life. And friends, if you're in Christ, you know exactly what we're talking about. You would long for that as well. So just think for a little bit about the path that you may be on this morning. It has a destination. Now, sometimes, if we're completely honest with ourselves, we have to look at where that destination is taking us, and we have to recognize that we've been focusing on a lot of things that are temporary rather than the important and eternal things that God wants us to do in our life. I don't think anybody should focus their lives entirely on the things of the flesh, but we should focus on the eternal things that God has given to us, because by comparison, the things of this world are nothing to what God has prepared for us. I love the way the songwriter put it. When we put our eyes on Jesus and we focus on him, the things of this world grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Sometimes people are on a path called achievement. You know, it's like, I want to make sure that I get all the accolades this world can offer me. I want to get all of the joys that this world can present to me. But be reminded of this, friend, that you can get everything the world gives you, But if you don't please God with your life, what does it gain you? If you don't find the eternity that God has prepared for you, what does it gain you? You know, in the scriptures, Jesus tells a story about a man who lived for the world and tried to gain everything that the world had. And Jesus reminded him, well, tonight, your soul is going to be required of you. So what good will all those things that you've stored up for yourself do? Maybe we should be laying up for ourselves treasures in heaven that will, in a place where they'll never rust or moth will never get in to destroy them. They'll always be there as a blessing for our God. So we're sending them ahead of us. So we just be reminded of those things. There's a lot of paths that we can take. But the path that we choose, the one that brings us closer and closer to the Lord, will bring us fulfillment and joy. Joy that's unspeakable, joy that's beyond the ability to describe, a joy that comes from just knowing that I'm with God and God's with me. But let me tell you, in order to get to that place, you've got to go on the path that leads by Calvary and the cross that Jesus died on for you and for me. You see, I had to come to that point in my life, just as you have, perhaps, or maybe you must, where I acknowledged the fact that I was a sinner before God and that there was nothing in my life that was good and noble and just, and all of the goodness of my life that I could muster up would never overcome the fact that I was sinful and that I was in rebellion against God. And God in His mercy and love sent His only begotten Son into the world to die for my sins at Calvary. He laid down His life on that cross and became my Savior, giving me the opportunity to come to Him and experience grace like I've never experienced it before. And on that day, many years ago in my life, when I prayed and I asked Jesus to come into my life, to forgive my sins and to be my Savior and Lord, life changed for me forever. I was born again into the family of God. And if you're without Christ today, you can make that same decision. You can choose to accept Jesus as Savior and Lord in your life because the sacrifice that He made at Calvary is enough for you. And the path that we walk in this life has to go by there, or we're really not experiencing life. But after it leaves Calvary, it goes by a tomb, an empty tomb, an unnecessary tomb, an unused tomb, because Jesus is alive. He's alive, He's powerful, and He's able to make a difference in your daily life and your daily walk for the Lord. He can restore your joy. He can give you strength and hope. He can give you a purpose, direction. He can give you all the things that you're longing for in life if you'll just come and offer yourself to Him. This is what God is offering to us this morning. And I would be remiss if I'd say, why would you choose anything else except God's way for your life? God's way is always going to be the best for you. So let me just give you one final encouragement this morning. Let Jesus be that lasting source of real joy by doing one simple thing. Solomon wrote of this years before Jesus was ever born, but I think it was prophetically thinking about some of the things that we need to be doing in our own lives. He said, trust the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him and let Him direct your paths. Guys, listen to me. I understand how life works. I realize that some days are just hard. Some days we're looking around and we're wondering, God, why do I have to go through this? Why do I have to endure these times like this? I mean, we're right in the middle of something like that that's getting a lot of people down right now. But understand this, when we acknowledge God, when we trust Him, when we remain faithful to Him, we can be joyful. We can be strong. We can remain faithful because He's there with us. He's there to guide us and direct us and to keep us near to Him. So keep your eyes on the one who lived for you, who died for you, and who lives again forevermore. Seek Him daily. Let His Word dwell in your heart richly. Let it grow up into you and let it become something special. Let His way of thinking become your way of thinking, so much so that you're looking upon Him, you're so close to Him that you begin to imitate His ways. You become just like Him, and watch where God takes the testimony of your life. Amazing things are awaiting. We can do great things for our Lord. It's time to trust. It's time to have that joy restored in our lives. It's time to be faithful to our God, because God is always going to be faithful to us. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I pray that each day of our lives we'll be reminded of the gift of joy that you've given to us, the gift of your presence, and every day we'll walk just in faith and fellowship with you. We'll be close to you, Lord. We'll just choose to make you the center part of our being. And God, I pray that in these moments of decision that we've come to in our service today, Lord, that you'll speak to many hearts, the hearts of many people, and just remind them, dear Lord, of how you can work in our lives as we surrender to you. Lord, maybe there's somebody here who just needs to come and just have the joy of their life restored. Give them the courage to call out to you and say, God, give me joy, just like David did. Maybe there's somebody here who feels weak, Lord, and just feels a little bit like the world's overwhelming them at the moment. God, become that shelter and that rock for them. Become the fortress of their life that they can know that they can always rely upon, because you're always faithful and you're always there for them. Lord, maybe you're speaking to the hearts of people in a way that I haven't even mentioned this morning, but yet you're sharing with them that there's a need that they need to come and give to you. I just thank you that you know exactly what we need. You know exactly when we need it, and you know exactly how to provide it. And so, God, I pray that you would give each one the courage to reach out to you, to find you, to trust you, and to choose to live before you, close to you. Lord, I know you're going to make a difference today in the lives of your church, and maybe in the lives of some who are without you this morning, by calling them to the salvation that you offers. Lord, I just pray that you'll work in a mighty way. Be glorified, Lord, in what you do. And we'll praise you and thank you always in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, listen to me. There are a lot of decisions in life that we have to make. Some of them are easy and some of them are not so easy. I'm going to give you a real easy one to make this morning. If you're walking down this road of life and you feel like you're all alone and you're by yourself and you're having to hold up everything on your own, maybe you would choose to trust Jesus as Savior. Turn to Him. Let Him be Lord in your life. God wants to be a resource for you, not just for eternity when you die, but He wants to be there in your life every moment while you live in this flesh. He wants to empower you, enable you, embolden you, make your life a blessing to your family and others. Give your life to Christ. Find the eternity that is yours in Him. Surrender your heart to Him and let Him forgive you of your sins and find your hope in Him. Maybe you don't know how to do that. And let me encourage you to just go to our website. As I said earlier, we have some resources there that you can look at, and they will help guide you on the God's plan for your salvation. If you'd like, give me a call. Our contact information will be at the end of this video, and you can connect with me, and I'd be glad to share with you over the phone or through some other medium that we can connect with. But don't leave this place, and don't let this time escape from you without giving everything that you have to God. And Christian, look at your life right now. You know, these are moments where Satan is working in us to steal away our joy, to steal away our vitality and our walk of faith. Stay faithful to God. Stay faithful to your study of His Word. Stay connected to one another. Let God fill you up with a greater joy than you understand. God can do that. We just have to trust Him. I'm asking for God's blessing to be in your life this week, and I'll be praying for each of you all week long. Know that God's going to do some special things in your life this week, and I trust that He will. God bless you all, and we'll look forward to worshiping with you next week as well.
When peace like a river attends.